No one's sitting.
That's why you gotta wait till it's all full.
It's A already.
Thank you.
It's lovely to actually be able to see you as opposed to being in a dark room with no windows. This is very nice. It's a bit chilly, but it's good. I thought
15 and 14?
I'll come out of my dark, dingy, windowless room.
There we go.
And just, rather than like everybody else who actually goes out and tours because they're trying to sell you a new CD or promote something, just play you some music. Got nothing to sell you at all. And at the same time, I thought it'd be important just once in my lifetime to be surrounded by these musicians and those musicians up there that have all contributed to these scores over the years and just show them to you. And this crazy journey sort of started with this, the tall, lanky guy there. 40 years ago, when there was no school that would have us anymore, it became, how else do you afford baked beans? You gotta go out, make some music, and become friends, and we were right on the baked beans, right? We were right on the friendship, and we're still making music. And actually, years later, Nick Granny Smith, who that tall, lanky guy is, when Tony Scott came to me and said, you know, you wanted to do an action movie with choirs, I said yes instantly. I didn't really know anything about choirs. Oh, hang on, I'm on the wrong tune. God. Thank you, Nick. This is what happens. All right, let me just be honest. I don't do this for a living. I sit, you know? So if I'm gonna go and start talking about the wrong song because this is our daylight set as opposed to our night set. Now, let me tell you what I am gonna talk about. Let me just make this really quick. We're gonna do a track from Gladiator next. Yeah! And it involves my friend, Serena Russell. And I met her, oh God, you've got nice warm hands. Can I hold on to you? I met her when she was 4 years old, and she was just a little girl, a little bridesmaid. And we have been friends ever since. And we're still friends. She's gonna sing for you tonight. And if it's warm enough, my friend Pedro Eustache here, who is truly one of the great, great musicians in this world. Because it takes a really great musician to take somebody cut off a leg off a chair and make it sound like it comes, like it's the direct conduit to a person's heart. My friend Pedro, he's from Venezuela, and right now, Venezuela is in a lot of trouble, and so tonight I want to dedicate this piece to Venezuela.
Ladies and gentlemen,
the reader of the book. And this actually gives me an opportunity to introduce the guitar quartet, led by young Niall Marr here. Andy Page, all the way from Tasmania. Guthrie Govan. Oh, I like that. Let me say that again. Guthrie Govan. That's exactly how I feel. Actually, hang on, let me tell you something. That whole guitar bit in Gladiator, that was actually written for a friend of mine who I think is here tonight, Hector Pereira. And the whole reason for writing it was because he's a really amazing guitarist, and I thought I'll write something that's really sort of impossible to play. And somehow I got left holding the baby tonight on that one. But the last person in the guitar quartet is this young man over here, who I think is the best young composer I know, the really remarkable Steve Mazzaro. Now comes the worst part of the evening for you and for me, where, and actually it's what I do to every director, and every director fears this moment, where Hans plays the piano. Sorry.
Thank you.
Guthrie governed us all. Every night on this tour, I just sit there and I just listen. And every night on this tour, I'm floored by the risk you take. And I'm floored by the inventiveness. And I don't know how many gigs we've done by now, but he never, ever plays the same solo. Ever. Now, this next piece, very, very different. This next piece, actually, the idea of this, well, let me just describe the terrible life that a film composer has to live. This next piece, I had to write in Paris. It was terrible. And to make matters worse, we were shooting at the Louvre for 2 weeks. So there I was, all by myself, with nobody crossing in front of me, being able to look at all those pictures. That's actually it's the truth, but weirdly, the thing that didn't, it wasn't the pictures or any of that that inspired me, but what inspired me was looking out of the Louvre, and outside there's this really provocative, really modern pyramid that the architect Ian Pei built. I just love this idea of the modern sort of colliding with the classicism of the buildings of the Louvre. And I thought somewhere in between the space, between the classic and the modern, that's where something good is happening. And so I thought, I'll write basically a violin solo, which tonight, my friend Molly Roger, Molly Rogers. No, I think, do you like this? Do you like the French bit? Yeah, okay, no. Okay, play French tonight, all right? So her job is to do the solo violin part, and she's going to be all by herself doing that while we throw a modern racket of electronics up against her. I hope she survives this one. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you a little story. Not such a little story, but this is a little ritual I have done every night now. And it goes something like this. From Soweto to Berkeley, I count the steps he has taken since I first met him when he was a political refugee in Los Angeles. And I count how far he's come. And with this, I remind both him and me how much has changed since we did The Lion King. We recorded Lion King 2 weeks before the general election in Africa, in South Africa, that gave him back his country. And at that moment in time, the studio and the music, there was a civil war going on outside. And so the studio and the music was sanity and it was refuge. And the choir would never leave. I mean, they turn up first thing in the morning, they're supposed to go home at 7 in the evening, 11 o'clock, midnight, everybody's still there because inside was music and outside was bloodshed. And I originally wrote Lion King for my daughter because she was 6 years old at the time and I wanted to, you know, Dad couldn't take her to a Ridley Scott movie, really, you know. So Dad wanted to show off, but let me introduce this one here. This is my friend Lever's daughter. This is Leafy. And all day she was walking around going, I don't have any voice left, I don't have any voice left, and she's been really sick. Yeah, right, okay. I mean, if that is not having any voice left, I don't know what it is, you know. But look, Lion King is this weird thing. Usually, you know, you put out a movie, it does whatever it does and it disappears. But Lion King's been around in our lives forever somehow, and you know, the stage play, etc. So you can go and see the musical, but what you can't do, get to do when you go and see the musical. All you get in the musical is an actor, but you can't get this guy. This is the real Lion King. This is my daughter, Lego Morocco. After this next thing, we're going to have a tiny intermission, but before we have this intermission, I would like you to just cast your eyes upon the great cellist that is Tina Grohl. What was that? Well, hey, I don't get that. So, Tina and I have been friends for a long time, and she truly is one of my, well, you are my favorite cellist. Not one off, let's just go and declare ourselves here, publicly. And I just want to tell you a quick thing about Tina. Tina and I were sitting around 2-3 years ago, which is highly unusual because Tina does not sit around. She's like Alan all the time, working, doing 3 sessions a day, doing a concert. She's probably doing another concert after this one. It's like you're the prince of cello, do you know what I mean? I mean, he never stopped playing. And so we're sitting around and she's telling me basically her life story. And she was born in China and started playing violin with at the age of 3. And her parents had a music school, so she could never not practice. And she was sort of practicing 8 hours every day. And we were sort of talking about the musician's life, because usually what happens is, you know, you're like a lawyer or dentist or somebody tells you they've been training and studying for years or whatever. And then we were thinking, we musicians, we start before, I mean, I can't remember when I started music. And that goes pretty much for everybody who's up there on the stage. We all started as tiny little children. But there's a special thing about it, because the operative word in music is play. And so all we've been doing all our lives is sort of learn how to take playing seriously and get better at it. And if you don't get down here soon, I'm going to run out of things to say. So what I wanted to say to you is what Tina and I have discussed and which we discovered was playfulness is not a bad thing. And even if you're not a musician, just have a bit of playfulness in your life. Trust me, these days things are pretty grim out there and you gotta have a bit of playfulness. So to set an example, Tina's going to perform a cello concerto for you tonight. And she's going to perform it with grace and with fire and with beauty. But I tell you what, with something else, she's going to take the playful part very seriously. Go on, knock their socks off.
Thank you.
ladies and gentlemen, the incredible and one and only Tina Crow. We'll be right back. I just write them. I don't play them. So that's why I get these two guys to play the impossible parts. On your left, you have the amazing Nathan Stonetta. All the way from Switzerland, which you can tell, obviously, by his position. And next to him, Bad Boy of Lambeth, which is part of Lambeth. Well, debatable. Gary Cattell, he's played on more film scores than anybody I know. So this next thing is a sort of it's a bit of a weird piece, but I love writing for the double bass. And Andy Pask, the master of the double bass, and friends, we've been friends for such a long time. Him there, and then more bass, talent, beauty, but most of all, groove. In the pocket groove, like forever. Ladies and gentlemen, Yolanda Charles. So this next thing, as I said, it's got double bass in it, it's a bit weird. We'll survive it, you'll survive it, just go with it. Thank you. incredibly excited about in the wrong point early on that I wanted to play. Because I love choirs, and this choir is led by the incredible Edie Bodica, who is one of the great loves of my life. So, let's just do it. Crimson Tide, here it comes.
Thank you.
really is just a biological experiment to see how long people can sing without breathing and still stay alive. Checking. Yes, seems to be like everybody's still there. It's turned over the last few months, it has turned more and more into a flamboyant guitar concerto for young Guthrie Govan. Which is the only way to do it. But I don't know if in the middle you might have noticed that my favorite drummer, my friend Satnam Rangotra, thank God, on either side of him, extraordinary talent, Holly and Asia. Oh, what's going on next? Can't remember. Oh, I do remember. Bit of superhero stuff. Man of Steel. actually very easy. Get all that Superman stuff. If you want to feel some real power, bring the Wonder Woman to the front of the stage. Yo, Pedro. Fancy a bit of Mozart? Okay.
There are no answers to our calling.
right. You know, when we did Batman Begins, we never ever thought we were going to do three movies. And what turned into three movies for you and me actually was 12 years of all of our lives. And it started with Chris Nolan phoning me and going, did I want to do a Batman movie? And you got to be a right old idiot to say no to want to do a Batman movie. So I wanted to do it, but I started to have these doubts about being able to sort of split my personality to be that dark and at the same time to be the elegant, suave Bruce Wayne. And Chris solved it simply by saying, hey, listen, phone your friend James Eaton Howard, who probably is the most elegant composer in the world, and see if he does the Bruce Wayne bit. And so the three of us went off to London, we did Batman Begins, and the film was successful enough that the studio pretty much asked for a sequel straight away. But Chris is never going to do anything unless he really has an idea, until he has an autonomous idea. So it took a while before he came over to my studio, and he started to talk to me about this character full of rage, full of anarchy, this character with a punk attitude, this character who was fearless, and weirdly, the only character in the movie that always tells you the truth. And I said to Chris, who's going to play this? Who's going to play the role of the Joker? He said, oh, there's this young actor called Heath Ledger. And Heath was amazing. He was fearless. He threw himself into that part. He was authentic. He was absolutely amazing. And every day, every time we saw a new scene, we saw dailies or something, you know, the way he shone like the sun from the screen, searing our eyeballs with the intensity of his performance. And just shortly before we finished the movie, we got the news that our Heath had died. And my first reaction was that I needed to take all the music down, I needed to take the punk attitude out, I needed to take the rusty razor blades across the steel strings out. I just needed to calm it all down until I realized that the only way I could truly honor this performance and the way I could only truly honor the man was to keep the danger, to keep the edge, to keep all the punk stuff in there. And a little while later, a while later Chris came and said, look, let's make it a trilogy. And we did Dark Knight Rises, we found our sense of adventure again, we found our sense of inventiveness again. And I remember finishing that and going to New York for our premiere, and the premiere was great, it was exciting. And we got onto a plane for our European premiere, and I remember arriving in London very early in the morning, and arriving in my apartment about 6:30, 7 o'clock in the morning, when the phone rings, and it's a journalist, and he's asking me what my reaction is to the terrible shooting, to the tragedy that happened in a small town in Colorado while they were watching our movie, a small town called Aurora. And I said, I hadn't heard of it. I mean, we were on the plane all night, all of us, none of us had heard of it. So I said the first word that came into my head, which was devastated. And all day I was thinking about the victims, and all day I was thinking about the loved ones they left behind, and all day I was thinking that a word is just not enough, and that I don't deal in words. And I phoned my friends in the choir and I said, is there any way we can make a piece of music without words, but it should feel like we're reaching out across the Atlantic, like we're stretching our arms out across the Atlantic, and we're embracing the people left behind in the small town in Colorado called Aurora. And you know something? The world hasn't gotten any better since. You know, Paris, London, Manchester, everywhere, Syria, everywhere we look, there's violence. But on this stage tonight, I have people from all over the world, from all continents. And just for you tonight, Berkeley, may we please stretch our arms out. May we play from our hearts for you. May we play this track. May we play for you. This is called Aurora. gentlemen. Thank you so very much. Thank you for having us. Thank you for being an extraordinarily good audience. But let's take our, hang on, one life lesson. Move on, okay. The choir, thank you for all the brilliant singing. Let's face it, you should always have a choir with you. And the orchestra. Thank you, young Ben. Thank you for everybody. You go back. Thank you. But last but not least, never last and never least, this band, this bunch of musicians, the best friends you can have, the best way you can spend your life, and you, because without you, we wouldn't be here. Be pointless. Thank you so much. Thank you and good night.
in Laugh at Bay, they can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and